Well, good morning. I'm Pastor Aaron. It's a joy and privilege to serve as a senior pastor here. Last week, Pastor Kyle preached a message. It was an excellent message on the already not yet of Christmas, speaking about hope. He did a great job, but there was one thing that he didn't have, and that was the proper setting. Because if you remember last week, it was like fall day, beautiful weather. God knows I need some help, so preaching Advent season, he added a nice backdrop of white snow and cold weather, so it's everybody feels like it's finally in the Christmas mood, right? But we are on a series this Christmas season talking about the already and not yet of Christmas. And today we're talking about the already and not yet of Christmas peace. And when I talk about peace, when you hear the word peace, I wonder what comes to mind. What do you think about when you think about peace? I think during this Christmas season, a lot of people have this picture of peace might be that glimpse of the Christmas setting or the Christmas card with the tree with the lights and the presents all around, and it's quiet evening and no one's around. That's a picture of peace, the absence of anything chaotic. Or a picture of peace perhaps for you is it's been a long few months, long few years at your workplace, and there's been a lot of turmoil and change and difficulty, and your picture of peace is just an absence of work. I don't have to deal with work right now. Or perhaps your picture of peace is you have young ones, and they're running all over the house, they're always busy, and your picture of peace is just a moment or two without the demands of the young ones. Where we have a picture of peace where there is just no more fighting in that relationship that we have that constant conflict with. Our pictures of peace are often of absence or of lack of conflict or lack of chaos. When we think of peace, we also think often of something really abstract. Today, we prayed for Cameroon. It seems far away. It seems abstract to think of that peace could happen in Cameroon. When the angels come and say there's peace on earth, and we talk about peace on earth today, again, it seems like this really big, far-off concept. Could there truly be peace on earth? We know our history. We know enough that what happens when people try to put peace in place, that Pax Romana of the Roman government or other governments through the years, when they try to put peace in place, it's often because of tyranny and violence that they put that peace in place. And so that peace on earth would happen, again, seems this far off, distant concept. When we think of peace, we often think of it in the abstract. When we think of peace, we often think of it in the absence of conflict or violence or tension. But biblically, peace is much more, is much richer and much more personal than that. When in Luke chapter 2, the story that was read this morning, Luke chapter 2, when the angels declare glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace among those with whom he is pleased. That word peace, when the angels declare that in the Greek, that's irene. That's the Greek word for peace. But that peace here is connected to the Hebrew word for peace used in Isaiah and multiple other places. That peace of shalom, Isaiah chapter 9. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, Prince of Shalom. Of this increase of his government and of peace there will be no end, and on the throne of David and over his kingdom to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness, from this time forth and forevermore, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. Biblically, peace is so much more rich and so much more personal than we often think of. Biblically, peace stems from that Hebrew understanding of shalom. And shalom is not merely the absence of violence, of tension, of conflict, of chaos. But biblically, shalom is the presence of wholeness and righteousness and justice and love and purpose. Biblically, peace, the shalom, is things are the way they ought to be. All is right. There is the presence of righteousness. There is the presence of purpose. There is the presence of relationships. Biblically, when they're talking about peace, that peace is the peace of shalom, that there is wholeness again, that all is right. Again, we have this picture of perhaps peace is the absence. Again, on a busy, chaotic time, if you have kids or family and they're all gathered into a room, oftentimes we think of peace, okay, everybody's on their device. Everybody's focused in on that. No one's talking. No one's arguing. No one needs to use the restroom. No one needs food right now. We have this picture there. So that's peace. But biblically, peace would be everybody in that room around a table, feasting and delighting, different cultures and backgrounds and ethnicities, all gathered in unity around that table with delight and provision and enjoyment and laughter and praise and rejoicing. That's the picture of shalom, not of just absence, but of this richness and this richness that comes through personal relationship. In fact, biblically, shalom probably has about four dimensions to it. When you think of biblical peace, there's four aspects to it. There is that peace that comes between us and God. There is that vertical peace. There is that peace between us and other people, that horizontal peace. There's that peace inwardly, that peace with ourselves. And there is that peace with creation, that we're in peace with this earth that we were called to steward and to take care of. But Jesus came to bring peace. Because as we all know, as we prayed for today, there is not peace right now on earth. There is a deep brokenness. There is not shalom everywhere. There is not this richness, because what happened thousands of years ago in the garden happens today in our hearts. See, in the garden, Adam and Eve went to war. They went to war with God. They wanted what God had. They had all this provision, all this abundance. They had shalom, and yet they went to war with God. They put themselves as God's rivals. They wanted to be lords and kings and to be in charge. And they put themselves in the center. And when they put themselves to the center, they broke themselves against God's holiness, against God's ways, against God's rules and reigns. They declared themselves equal with God, and they became enemies with God. Rivals. And friends, this may be the hardest part of this Sunday if you're visiting, if you brought a friend in, but the fact is that we are all at war with God. We are all against Him. We set up our own ways. That's what sin is. It's doing things our way for our glory, and we're going against God. And yet, what does God do? God seeks to deal with our warfare by sending a Savior, one who will bring about peace, peace with us and God, peace with ourselves, peace with others, and even peace over all of creation. That's the promise of Christmas, that Jesus will bring about peace. And you see that as He enters into this world. He enters into a world like ours, a world of chaos, a world of refugees and immigrants, a world of nations at war, of a world where there's pain and hurt and darkness. He enters into that world. And when he, through his ministry, where you see Jesus, you see shalom. Jesus brought about the peace that we were made to experience. That wholeness. Wherever Jesus went, he wove, he knitted back together the way things ought to be. For those at war with God, he brought about forgiveness of sins. He forgave sins. For those set apart from the community, rejected and cast out at war because or oppressed because of a disease or a sickness, he brought healing and brought them back in to the community. When the creation was at war, the storms raged. What did he do? He calmed the storm. When people needed food, when there was an absence of food and provision, he fed the multitudes. Where there was a lack of teaching, he brought truth. Where there was a lack of, where there was oppression, he brought freedom. Wherever Jesus went, he brought true peace, true shalom. So you can imagine the disciples, when they heard that Jesus was going away, when he was talking about the cross in John chapter 14, you can imagine their fear. John 14, Jesus is saying he's going away. He's going to lay down his life. And then John 14, verse 26-27, he says, "Now, peace I leave you with. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give it to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid." Jesus is promising them peace. He has taken the initiative. He has pursued healing with the relationship with God and with others and with creation. And the disciples had to have a foretaste of this, a glimpse of this, experience of this peace, of what it truly means to be made whole. And then Jesus says he's leaving, and they are full of the opposite of peace, which is fear. And Jesus says, "No, I'm going to leave you, give you a greater peace. A peace I will now leave with you. A peace I will now give to you." He is talking about his death and his resurrection, that through that he will now give a peace that will never leave to those who trust in him because of his righteousness. For our sins, we will be made right before God. Because of all his forgiveness, now he gives us, we will never experience God's wrath. We have his righteousness, his forgiveness, and we have that secured, that core dimension, that primary dimension, our relationship with God. Jesus is saying, because I am leaving, because I am going to the cross, and then I will rise again, you can be secure. I will give you a peace that no one else in this world can experience because your relationship with God will now be restored. Our hearts are restless till they rest in thee. You can have that peace. That is the peace that Jesus offers. That is the peace that Jesus came to bring. That is the peace that the angels declared. That is the first part of that peace. And that peace promises to continue to grow. The already but not yet. That is the first dimension that has begun to put in place. And when you begin to experience that peace, you begin to experience less of that shame in your heart, less of that brokenness because of the sins, less of that struggle inwardly because now you're made right. And then there's less sin in your life. When you're less of the center of the world, there's less sin in your relationships with others. God begins to put back shalom or peace through Jesus. The declaration of the angels, the promise of Isaiah, the promise for us today is that we can know that peace already. We can know that peace right here and right now. In December of 1944, Second Lieutenant Hiro Onoda was part of the Japanese Army. He was sent to a Philippine island, and he was told to prevent any American advance. He was sent there. If you know history, you know the war ended in 1945. But the second lieutenant never got word of this. He spent the next 30 years of his life fighting in a war that didn't exist anymore. The next 30 years he spent stealing food, shooting shots at people who would advance, rejecting the truth that people would put out in newspaper articles, and even his brother was put on loudspeaker to tell him that the war is over. He's kept on fighting and living his own war. It took 30 years before they finally brought his old Japanese commander to the island, who told him to surrender, that he finally surrendered. And he finally experienced the peace that was already present. Friends, this morning, that's the peace of Jesus is provided to you. You don't have to fight with God anymore. You don't have to be his enemy, his rival. He is the one who you has been offended, and yet he took the first step, the second step, the third step, all the way to the cross for you, so that you no longer would be at war with God, so that you could know true peace with God. Friends, we didn't just have a commander telling us to surrender. We have the God of the universe who sent God the Son to us so that we would let down our arms, so that we would stop resisting, so that we would surrender and know peace. Have you surrendered? Do you know that true peace, that true wholeness that comes from knowing God, from having that opposition with him removed and replaced with sonship and daughtership, a relationship that is secure, that you know is certain because of the cross and the resurrection? That is offered to us today. Friends, I would encourage you not to miss that message of Christmas. That today, at this very present moment, you can know peace. And the scripture tells us that we are called to know that in increasing ways. Colossians 3:15 says, "Now, if you know that peace of Christ, now let that peace of Christ reign in and rule in your heart." Let that peace rule and reign. The already, but not yet full, that doesn't mean we just sit back. It means that the scripture teaches us that when we know God, we can know his peace in increasing ways in our life. That when that disappointment happens, when that uncertainty comes before us and we are tempted to turn to fear, when we're tempted to turn to doubt, we can let the peace of Christ reign in our hearts, knowing that God's goodness in Jesus is greater than this uncertainty, is greater than what we cannot see. We can let God's peace reign in our hearts when we know that even though we've made mistakes, that when we look at our past, that we know that God's grace, that God's forgiveness is greater than our sin. And so we can let that peace rule and reign in our hearts. When we are going through difficulties and trials and tribulations, like the disciples were about to, we have this assurance from Jesus that you can know peace. You can know peace because his sovereignty, His goodness, His power is greater than the present trial or tribulation. You may not see how it's going to work out, but you have the assurance that even the path to the cross turned to glory and healing, so that your path right now, I don't know what you're going through, but your path of suffering and difficulty, if you know Jesus, there is this assurance that one day that God will use that for good, that one day you will see how that brought Him glory, that one day He will wipe away those tears and those sufferings. Therefore, let the peace of Christ rule and reign in your heart, no matter what is going on. That is the peace that we can know. And that is the peace that we can share with others. When we know peace with God, and we are beginning to experience that peace of Christ reigning within us, we can begin to show peace to those around us. No longer do you have to win every argument. No longer do you have to be at the center of everything. No longer do you have to strive to get what you want. No longer do you have to fight in order to make yourself, give yourself identity. All of that is provided to us in Jesus Christ. So we can have a confidence now, a confidence to now no longer seek to rule or reign over others. When we're real, that's what we're trying to do. And instead of trying to rule and reign over others because we know God's peace, we can now rise up to serve and to lift others up and do what would be best for them. We can care for them. Instead of ruling and reigning, we can lift up and serve. And I know that God works through small steps. I know that my God works through mustard seeds. I know that God worked through a baby, and He will work through baby steps in our relationships with others to bring about peace in this world. Imagine, don't imagine, just imagine, but live it now. In your home, in your workplace, in your community, that you have God's peace. Therefore, you can be a person of peace. You can stand for what's right, knowing that you don't have to, you have confidence in God with you. Imagine you're a barista right now during this chaotic season. If you're dealing with first world problems and trying to get to Starbucks, you know the challenge is out there. Imagine if you're a barista that knows the peace of Christ. You can let that peace now flow out to all those who are coming into the store who are so frazzled during the season. You can affirm their dignity. You can be pleasant. You can be loving. You don't have to fight with your coworkers over tips. You have this peace of Christ, and that can shape how you work. That can shape how you live during this Christmas season in relationships with others. This peace is not yet fully here, but already we can live it out. And when there comes times like Cameroon, when there come times like the North Minneapolis violence, when there come times of difficulty and challenge, and we say, we desire peace in this community, peace in this world, we can have this assurance that we may see but pockets or glimpses or brief moments, but because of Jesus Christ, true peace is coming. True shalom will come. True God's kingdom will be here one day. And because of that sure promise, we don't have to be anxious. We don't have to be worried. We don't have to live in fear. I have a confession. I got caught up with the Star Wars movies. It's been a while since I watched the first three, what, when they came out, like, I'm old, 40, 30 years ago, and then I haven't watched them all till lately, and I started going through 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and going all the way, and I was at the 9th one, and I confess that I stayed up last night watching it. I was watching, and I was like, okay, I really should go to bed, but it's really good, and then it got really, really late, and I'm not going to give you it away, but one of the beloved characters appears to have perished, and I was literally stressed last night, and for the first time ever, I thought about skipping ahead, because I looked at the clock, and I was like, I can't watch it. I want to skip ahead and see what happens with this character. Do they really die, or do they live? I wanted to look at the end so that I could have peace before I went to sleep. I've never done this with a book. It was a real temptation last night, but I finally said, you know what? I'm not going to do it. I'm just going to save it for today. So don't give it away. But I wanted to see the end so that I could have peace to be able to sleep. As it was, I had trouble getting to sleep because I kept on thinking, will this person die? Will they come back? How are they going to make it work out? Friends, that's kind of a silly illustration, but the same truth applies. We know what the end will be. We know that true peace will be here. We may not understand all the details, but we've been given the opportunity to fast forward. That picture from Isaiah chapter 9 has been given to us. Isaiah chapter 9 says that the Prince of Peace has come. And his increase of his government and of peace, there will be no end. So we have this assurance. We have this peace. We can know it, and we can continue to live it out. Let me pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for what peace truly is, that richness, that wholeness, that way it ought to be. Lord, I pray that you would help us to hunger and yearn for more of it, that Christ would rule and reign in each one of our hearts, that he would rule and reign in how we treat one another, and that he would rule and reign when anxiety and fear strikes at us and we wonder what's coming next. We would have that deep assurance that of your kingdom, because of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection, there is a kingdom of peace that is coming, and we have that great assurance. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.